Thank you. My way, please, Brian. National anthem. Emeritus Professor, visiting vice chancellors from sisters' institution, His Royal Highnesses, top government functionaries, staff and students, invited guests, gentlemen of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to welcome every one of you to today's inaugural lecture. This is the 186th in the inaugural lecture series of the University of Benin, to be delivered by Professor Onolosi Arai. Topic: African Trypanosomin, a review of the lethality and control of an enduring pathogen. May I humbly invite the registrar, O.A. Oshodi Mrs., to introduce the Vice Chancellor and members of the Vice Chancellor's profession, the registrar.
Distinguished invitees, you are all welcome to the 186th inaugural lecture series of the University of Benin. Please permit me to stand on the existing protocol already observed by the University PRO as I introduce the Vice Chancellor's entourage. It is my rare privilege and honor to introduce the Vice Chancellor's entourage, which is led by the Vice Chancellor himself, Professor F.F.O. Orumesi. Others in the Vice Chancellor's entourage are the Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration, Professor J.O. Egiorobo. We also have the Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, Professor P.E. Irowobo. We have representing the Liberian, University Liberian, we have Mr. Obasui. We have representing the BOSA, Mr. Echi. We also have Provost, Deans and Directors. We have, on the other side of the dais, Provost College of Medical Sciences, Professor B.I. Yawe. We have the Dean School of Postgraduate Studies, Professor Victor E. Omoziwa. We have the Dean of Students, Professor O.B. Osadolo. We have the Host Dean, School of Basic Medical Sciences, Professor Mrs. H. Okay, representing, we have H.A. Obo. We have the Dean, Faculty of Agriculture, Professor M.A. Bamikoli. We have the Dean, Faculty of Arts, Professor L. Otoedi. We have the Dean, School of Dentistry, Professor O. N. Obwekwe. We have the Dean, Faculty of Engineering, Professor F. A. Aitie. We have representing the Dean of Faculty of Law, Professor N. Inebidio. We have the Dean, Faculty of Life Sciences, Professor O. I. Inabulele. We have representing the Dean, School of Medicine. I'm sorry, she's the host dean. The host dean representing the Dean, School of Medicine, is Professor O.A. Awoju, the host dean. We have representing the Dean, Faculty of Pharmacy, Professor A.C. Opara. We have the Dean, Faculty of Physical Sciences, Professor panel. We also have directors. We have Director Center for Gender Studies, Professor Mrs. E. U. Edosoma. We have the Director Center for Part-Time Programs, Professor K.A. Igafuna. We also have Director IPAES, Professor S.O. Ibeyi. We have the Director of Distant Learning Program, Professor F.E.O. Omoruyi. We have the Acting Director, Institute of Education, Dr. D. Omorupe. We have the Acting Director, Center for Entrepreneurship Development, Dr. A. E. Ubani. We also have the Acting Director, Center for Maritime Studies, Dr. It is now my pleasure to call on the Vice Chancellor to introduce the lecturer of the day, the Vice Chancellor.
Please permit me to stand on the existing protocol. I'm glad to welcome you all to the 186th inaugural lecture of the University of Benin. Today's lecture, it is the 39th to be delivered in my tenure as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Benin. And the 38th to be delivered in the College of Medical Sciences. And the 29th in the School of Medicine, University of Benin. As part of my routine update on activities at the university, I am glad to inform you that the second semester lectures for the 2016-2017 academic section has successfully taken off in the various faculties, schools, and institutes. I want to use this medium to appreciate you all, the stakeholders in the university, for the support so far. Deans, directors, and HOD should please ensure that lectures are going on uninterrupted. I also want to appeal to all students to pay their charges for quick processing of all records and documents related to their academic status. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to now introduce our lecturer for the day, Professor Mrs. Uno Lucy Ayarawoyi, whose lecture will be on African Entrepreneurship, a review of the lethality and control of an enduring pathogen. Professor Lucy Uno Ayarawoyi was born on the 14th day of August 1954 in Agbor to late Mr. Philip Iyore and late Mrs. Lucy Enomore Iyore ni Isangbedo. She attended All Saints Primary School, Yaba, Lagos, from 1959 to 1965. She began her secondary school education at the Our Ladies of Lourdes, Uromi, in 1966, and later in 1967 went to St. Maragoriti Secondary School, Benin City, where she obtained her West African School Certificate in 1970. She attended the Institute of Medical Laboratory Sciences of Nigeria from 1974 to 1978, after which she did her National Youth Service in the defunct Benue State in 1979. Professor Mrs. Harawi, enrolled for and obtained the postgraduate diploma in parasitology in the Nigerian Institute of Medical Laboratory Science in 1988. She obtained her MSc parasitology in 1990 and went on to conclude her PhD in parasitology at the University of Benin. She began her academic career at the University of Benin in 1992 as a research fellow, too, and was promoted to the rank of full professor of parasitology in 2009. Her spheres of specialization include the diagnosis, epidemiology, clinical significance, genetic diversity, and taxonomy of parasites and infectious disease agents. Professor Mrs. Harawi has served in various capacities within and outside the University of Benin, among which are internal examiner, undergraduate examination in the School of Medical of Medicine, University of Benin, coordinator of pathology, School of Medicine, University of Benin, member Central Examination Committee from 2004 to 2008, member Board of University Center of Pattern Program, and many more. After the University of Benin, she has served as a resource person for the revision course for pathology primaries in the Faculty of Pathology of the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria. She was also a visiting scholar in the College of Life Sciences at the Virginia Technical Institute and the State University, Virginia, USA, during her sabbatical for the 2013-2014 session. While on sabbatical, she conducted studies on comparative genomics and is currently involved in collaborative work at the Virginia Institute, where she has completed and passed a training course on the utilization of animals in teaching and research. Professor Mrs. Harawi has published numerous articles at international, national, and local conferences and proceedings. She has contributed to the advancement of knowledge with over 40 publications in both local and international peer-reviewed journals, book chapters, and conference proceedings. She is also a top-cited Nigerian author in medical microbiology and parasitology, and her name is familiar to trypanosomiasis researcher largely through her contribution to the understanding and control of human trypanosomiasis in Nigeria through her work on TB in the Niger Delta area of Nigeria. She has supervised many undergraduates, master's and PhD students within and outside the University of Benin. Professor Mrs. Harawi is a member of the Nigerian Society of Parasitology, Association of Biomedical Sciences, South African Society of Parasitology, and an associate member of the London Institute of Medical Laboratory Science. Professor Mrs. Harawi is happily married her marriage has blessed with 5 children. Her hobbies include reading and writing. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure and honor to invite Professor Mrs. Lucy Ono Harawi, Professor of Anthropology. Thank you.
Ashram Senator, Professor F.F.O. Oruwesi, Fellow Nigerian Society of Engineers, Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration, Professor G.J. Ehirobo, Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, Professor P. Iribogbe, Deputy Vice Chancellor Ekawa Campus, Professor George Eria Memro, the Registrar, Mrs. O.A. Oshodi, the Bursar, Dr. Baba Bila, the Librarian, Dr. Mrs. Idiodi, the Provost, College of Medical Sciences, Professor P.I. Iyawe, Deans and Directors, Members of Senate of the University of Benin, distinguished guests, gentlemen of the press, great university students. This inaugural lecture is dedicated to the Almighty for his faithfulness to me and to my family. The order of presentation will be as shown. It's going to run through the dedication up until the recommendations. The Vice Chancellor, sir, I am indeed delighted and grateful to you for your kind approval of my application to give my inaugural lecture today. I'm highly honored and privileged to inform this distinguished audience and the general public of my research career today, and also to update my colleagues on my current and future research directions. I would like to briefly present some of my research activities and contributions to knowledge before I present the lecture for today. My research focuses on microbe hunting, host-pathogen interaction, diagnosis, epidemiology, clinical significance, genetic diversity, taxonomy of parasites and infectious disease agents, also the evaluation of risk factors predisposing to parasitic and infectious diseases based on the principles aimed at promoting health and preventing illness. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, through prevention of infection and disease, my research promotes wellness. My PhD research study reported the pattern and histopathology of parasitic diseases in our environment. I have also conducted studies on experimental parasitology, including my MSc research study, which was on onchopsychiasis due to Onchopsycha amyloide. The methodology included the breeding of laboratory bred clean mosquitoes called Culex pipens fatigans, which were experimentally infected with microfilaria for further studies. I have been involved in collaborative studies designed to provide research-based responses to problems facing humanity since 1992. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, through my research endeavors, I have contributed to knowledge with some of my findings that include studies on malaria. Malaria is highly endemic in Nigeria and is also a major public health problem. Concerning childhood malaria, we conducted a study to report diarrhea and malaria in children, and we found a statistically significant positive association between the severity of dehydration and malaria parasitemia. The conclusion was that there should be a high index of suspicion of malaria in children with severe diarrhea, even if there's positive or clinical signs of malaria. Ibadin, Airawi, Omoigbirale, and Abiodun 2000. Furthermore, we observed that late presentation of children with malaria to the hospital predisposes to malaria anemia. We reported risk factors that are relevant in the control of malaria morbidity and mortality in Nigeria. Ibadin, Opili, Airawi, Osabohe, and Osawe 2006. In order to document risk factors for fatal outcome of malaria, we compared parasitological, hematological, and biochemical indices during mild and severe malaria in relation to outcome among children aged 5 years and below. Airawi and Ibadin 2003. We found that abdominal scarification, I mean the marks that you can see on the abdomen of that child. In some native language in Ishan, which it is called Ude. Ishan and Edo language refer to abdominal scarification as Ude. We suggested the need to urgently check the trend because of its potentials to negate efforts involved in malaria control in Nigeria. Ibadin, Opili, Airavi, Ozola, and Umoru, 2008. Because some mothers believe that only spiritual healers have the expertise to treat malaria, they often seek care for their sick children in the wrong places. We were not surprised to find a significant higher risk of complicated malaria among children who were cared for by mothers with the wrong perception, belief, and definition of malaria. We recommended health education programs in order to correct the trend. Idogun and Airavi, 2009. Treatment practices and health-seeking behavior studies for perceived malaria revealed that self-diagnosis was most common, with home management as the first response. We reported various treatment outcomes according to educational levels. It is likely that the pathway through which home treatment practices and health-seeking behavior decisions are made include knowledge and awareness of the benefits of the use of appropriate anti-malaria as well as in the right dose. Yusuf Iyoha, Naira, 2012. Also, we recommended that failure to get cured after home treatment for perceived malaria following appropriate use of anti-malarial and in the right dose, such cases should be reported promptly to orthodox health institutions. This is important in order to prevent over-treatment of malaria and the associated risks of neglecting other illnesses that may require urgent medical care. Yusuf Iyoha, Adaira, in 2014. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, at this point, I'd like to offer my appreciation to colleagues at the University of Benin. I offer my sincere appreciation to you, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, for the learning and research opportunities provided me by the University of Benin. To Professor E.P. Kubenje and Professor O. Oshodi for my promotion to the ranks of Associate Professor and Full Professor, respectively. To the Registrar, Mrs. O. Oshodi, I'm grateful to you for your kindness and support. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I would like to appreciate some professors at the University of Benin, Professor E.G. Olisa of Blessed Memory, for his advice and assistance towards the development of my career along the path of post-pathogen interaction. Also, I'm grateful to Professor B.A. Obiamiwe of Blessed Memory for the valuable and constructive suggestions during the planning and development of my postgraduate research studies. Also to Professor C.E. Okaka for his encouragement and useful critics of my postgraduate research as my supervisor. I have been influenced by many years of mentoring by Professor Dennis Agmolaho and the loving care of his wife, Mrs. Nike Agmolaho. I thank you, sir and ma'am, for your love and care for me over the years till today. Thanks to the current Provost, College of Medical Sciences, Professor V.A. Yawe, for his assistance and support for me always, and the current Dean, School of Medicine, Professor M. Momo, for your encouragement and support. I must remember to thank the current CMD of the UBTH, my brother, Professor Michael Ibadin, for his interest in my research over the years, for believing in me so much and his willingness to assist me at all times. Special thanks to my brother and sister, Mr. and Professor Mrs. Opili. My profound gratitude goes to former Dean's School of Medicine and Provost College of Medical Sciences. In particular, I must mention Professors L.I. Ojogu, E. Obiasu, A. Issa, P. Abiodun, F. Okonofua, and Ufomata for giving me the opportunity to serve the school and the college. Thanks to Professor M.K.D. Harlan for his kindness and support. To Professors A.I. Omoigberale, E.G. Ofowe, and S. Idogun for collaborative studies. Thank you, Professor and Mrs. C. Okonkwo, for always being there for me. My inaugural lecture is the 186th in the University of Benin series of lectures, and it is titled African Trypanosome, a review of the lethality and control of an enduring pathogen. It is the second to be delivered from the Department of Medical Microbiology. The first was the 61st and it was on the immunology of leprosy, which is a bacterial disease, delivered by Professor S.N.C. Wemambu of blessed memory. It was titled, Leprosy, Scourge of Ages, Whither Do You Go? My lecture is on a parasitic disease, therefore my focus will be to discuss the molecular basis for the lethality of a protozoan parasitic pathogen and its control. The African trypanosome is a parasite that causes African trypanosomiasis. The disease can occur in humans and animals, and it is commonly known as sleeping sickness and nagana respectively. Except it is diagnosed and treated quickly, the disease is lethal, meaning it will eliminate the victim. The disease is endemic in Nigeria, including parts of Edo and Delta states, and there are no vaccines or prophylactic drugs for its prevention. The available medication for the treatment are toxic, with unpleasant side effects, and this often results in poor patient compliance that further worsens the prognosis of people with the disease. This presentation provides the unique opportunity of understanding some aspects of the structure and pathogen-associated molecular pattern of the African trypanosome, as well as field activities conducted in Edo and Delta states aimed at controlling the deadly disease for the betterment of society. Sleeping Sickness Reawakes is the title of the article by Pierre Catan, warning of the dangers of the disease in Africa in 1998. Pierre Catan was a training officer with the Trypanosomiasis and Leishmaniasis unit at the World Health Organization Geneva. I was privileged to meet with him when I took some of his courses during the second international training course on trypanosomiasis in Lyon, France, which held in 2001. The disease, which is endemic in several countries of sub-Saharan Africa, was first reported in Boko, Nigeria, within the tropical savannah in 1948, Ayedun and Amodu, 1976. In 1983, the first report of the disease was documented in Eku, in the former Benue state within the tropical rainforest, where et al., 1985. While conducting my PhD research studies between 1991 and 1994 at the UVTH Benin City, I came across an unusual blood pathogen. This curious finding was the first report of trypanosomiasis in Edo State, IRHE 1994. Following this unusual report, control efforts and field activities were conducted to control trypanosomiasis with the full cooperation and participation of the affected communities. Some of the studies include a prevalent study of the disease in three villages in the Delta State, IRHE et al. 2000, knowledge, attitude and beliefs about the disease, IRHE et al. 2001, geographical description and mapping out of the disease focus, IRHE et al. 2002. Active case finding studies funded by the World Health Organization were conducted in Edo and Delta States, IRHE et al. 2003. The African trypanosome is a microscopic organism, which is shown in the photograph that I have here. They are usually extracellular and they are therefore exposed to adaptive and innate immunity of the host. And yet, they are able to perpetrate and cause a lethal disease in humans. The ultrastructural organelles reveal those that are typical of the eukaryotic organism. Some of the structures of these organisms that are relevant in this virulence we will briefly take a look at. The first is the VSG, the variant surface glycoprotein, which is the coat covering the organism. And it is responsible for protecting the organism against the immune system. Therefore, the VSG plays a pivotal role in host responses to African trypanosome. The flagellum, which harbors multiple virulence factors, facilitates propulsion, mediates attachment and migration to specific host tissues, including crossing the blood-brain barrier, which is a critical defining step of disease progression. The flagellar pocket is where endocytosis and exocytosis occur, It is the site of surface protein turnover and nutrient uptake. It accommodates export of extracellular macromolecules. The flagella pocket is also involved in immune evasion. Redenco 2011. The genome of the trypanosome consists of about 10,000 genes, and 10% of these code for the VSG, Donaldson 2002. Of the 10% genes, only one gene is expressed at a given time from the telomeric expression site, which is involved in antigenic deletion and evasion of adaptive immunity. Donaldson 2002, Marcel and Barry 2007. During my sabbatical for the 2013 and 2014 session, I was privileged to undergo training courses in animal use, in teaching and research on molecular biology at the Virginia Technical Institute and State University, Virginia, USA. The training in molecular biology afforded me the opportunity of studying comparative genomics, including DNA isolation, and this involves the following basic steps. The removal of the lysing of the cell in order to expose the DNA, the removal of membrane lipid, the removal of proteins, and the purification of DNA products for further studies. During DNA studies, the sample that is to be analyzed is processed using the PCR machine in order to release the DNA fragments. And then once the DNA fragments are released, they are processed in an electrophoresis field to allow the DNA particles to migrate. And the migration rates differ and is usually specific and diagnostic of different types of DNA. And when viewed under the UV light, which is what I'm doing over there, you can take gel picture, which you can study and use for further studies. This one shows gel picture, and it shows where at the beginning, those are the wells where you load whatever samples that you have processed with the PCR, and when you expose them to the electrophoretic field, they migrate at different rates. And when you compare it with the ladder, you are able to name the organism that is characteristic of the DNA isolated. Some of the objectives of DNA isolation include detection and purification of total DNA, genomic and mitochondrial, as well as pathogen DNA. Samples are derivable from fresh or frozen tissues, cells, blood, or pathogens. Each species of pathogen carries with it a unique DNA or RNA signature that differentiates it from other organisms. DNA signature for each microorganism or specimen of interest is isolated for rapid and specific detection. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I'm pleased to inform you and my colleagues that the knowledge acquired has been helpful to me in proposing molecular biology studies on the trypanosome. Some of my future research studies include analysis of mechanism of protective immunity, including their effects on host pathology, the use of animal model systems in experimental genomic studies, attenuation of parasites by the modification of target genes. At this point, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I would like to appreciate some of my colleagues at the Virginia Technical Institute. Professor Smith for the learning opportunity in comparative genomics, to June Su for her technical support, Limon Thorpe and Regina Wallace for their support and assistance. The transmission of trypanosome can be cyclical, mechanical, and by other methods. Cyclical transmission of the disease occurs when a person or animal is bitten by an arthropod vector, commonly known as the tsetse fly. The components of the fly saliva prevents blood coagulation and promotes vessel dilatation, which allows the easy passage of trypanosome into the mammalian blood vessel. An important first step in the initiation and establishment of infection while in the mammalian host is the white cell entry by the pathogen. Inside the white cell, the pathogen is able to undergo metabolic, morphological, and structural changes which is required for it to be able to survive, hence it is referred to as an enduring pathogen. This illustration just shows how the sensei fly transmits the disease to humans, does the same thing to the animal host. It perches on the unsuspecting host who is not even aware that the fly is piercing his skin and taking a blood meal. And most often refer to them as being more than just flying syringes. You can see this fly is sucking the blood. It's able to suck freely because the saliva contains anticoagulant, and you can see the abdomen getting engorged as it's feeding. It's doing more than feeding, because as it is feeding, it is also depositing the pathogen inside the host. So let's take a look at what happens. These are the trypanosomes released, and as I said before, I said they were extracellular. You can see them moving around extracellular, around red blood cells. And I also mentioned that they now begin to invade the white cell. That is the white cell. So it's like actually going to the white cell to get baptized, if you want to call it that, to arm itself in order to be able to deal a blow on the host. So it's taking a meal and at the same time transmitting the disease. So this is the fly that just perpetrated that heinous crime. So it has finished taking the blood meal and it flies away. Now it's, the patient is now left to deal with the after effect of that blood meal. This photomicrograph shows the sensei fly. It's prevalent in some parts of Edo and Delta states. The flies bite during daytime hours. They become infective about 21 days after feeding on an infected mama. They remain infective for life. Male and female flies transmit sleeping sickness. Atogwa and Kennedy 2000. Following transmission by sensei fly, the trypanosomes are the same. So this is a graphical picture of what you just saw. So this is the sensei fly on the outside, and this represents the skin that it bites through, deposits the trypanosome. And as we said before, we said that the trypanosome was motile and is propelled, aided by the flagellum. So it will actually climb through this blood vessel to reach the blood in order to begin to express itself in the form of disease. Sensei fly habitats are common in some parts of Edo and Delta states. In this photomicrograph, where during my field study, I actually went to River Etu with some of the inhabitants and part of my research team. We went down and we were able to observe the flies perching on plants and then on trees, biting some of the inhabitants walking the pathways to fetch water. And you can see this child is stark naked. And actually, sensei flies are attracted by moving dark objects. So this child was a perfect candidate for the sensei fly bite. In addition to cyclical transmission, I said before, cyclical transmission is that the fly takes a blood meal, and inside of the fly, the pathogen undergoes a cyclical development before it is transmitted. Aside from that, we also have mechanical transmission. And this can happen through the bites of other blood-sucking flies like the Tabanidae, Sharonet et al. 2004. Accidental infections have occurred in laboratories due to pricks from needles contaminated with the parasite. Transmission between humans via bodily fluid have also been documented, for instance, through sexual contact. Rocha et al. 2004. Mother-to-child transmission. Infection has also been documented by Olowe. Trypanosome can cross the placenta, warranting the need to screen neonates born to mothers infected with trypanosomiasis. Lidner and Prioto, 2010. African trypanosomiasis develops into a wasting disease for humans and animals. Pires de Sosa et al. 2011, with signs of emaciation and cachexia, mainly at the end stage of the disease. Rajit Kumar et al. 2012. The disease is characterized by progressive weight loss, depletion of skeletal muscle mass, loss of adipose tissue, systemic inflammation, and the modulation of appetite. You can see the effect of the disease both in animals and in humans. We said it was a wasting lethal disease. The trypanosome can alter neuronal function with the manifestation of the disruption of the sleep-wake 24-hour cycle, which is why the disease is caused, the disease cause is designated with the synonym sleeping sickness, Kennedy 2004. The main symptoms, which is daytime somnolence and nocturnal insomnia, the patient being sleepy during the day and restless at night. The sleep-wake cycle disturbances are accompanied with either or many other symptoms, which include headaches, sensory disturbances, psychiatric disturbances, etc. Disorders of the sleep-wake cycle are accompanied by a state of apathy in the patient. There's also loss of muscle tone, especially in the neck muscles, manifesting as drooping eyelids. Vincent Dow and Boutel, 2006. The disease can hide inside the human body for months or even years before the infected person shows characteristic signs of the symptom. The synonym, Nagana, I said before that the disease is called commonly known as Nagana in animals. Nagana is a Zulu word that means powerless or useless. Steve Adin, 2008. Nagana affects individual animals, health, and socioeconomic development. In susceptible animals, Nagana may be acute, but chronic infections are more common. The host-parasite interaction produces extensive pathology, including severe anemia. Clinically affected animals lose condition, and they become weak and unproductive. Nagana is often fatal. All aspects of livestock production are depressed. Fertility is impaired. Milk yields, growth, and work output are reduced. And the mortality rate may reduce head size. Trypanosoma species infected for animals are used as models for human infection studies in laboratories because they are susceptible to lysis by the human serum component known as the TLF. Trypanosome being a lethal and very dangerous disease, a lot of people want to conduct research into the parasite. But it is dangerous to conduct such research using human pathogens. So, using the African animal trypanosome that does not infect humans, you get useful results that you can use to implement treatment and management in humans. So TLF is able to eliminate the animal trypanosome, making it safe to be handled in the laboratory for experimental purposes. Application in experimental studies include genetic analysis of resistance and susceptibility to infection in animals, which is the basis for the research into equivalent genes in humans. Also, such studies are relevant in understanding the sequence of events involved in resistance, susceptibility to trypanosome in the development of the disease. The trypanosome is heterozygous, meaning it's going to alternate between two hosts, at some time between inside the mammalian host and at another time inside the vector host. So to be able to survive within these two hosts, the trypanosome is well adapted. And its adaptation also includes the expression of several genes that enables it to survive and endure and remain lethal in the human. The outcome of gene functions are intimately associated with the interplay involved in the following events: differentiation and proliferation of the trypanosome, resistance to human innate trypanolytic factor, and antigenic variation. The interplay of these three events that I just enumerated enables the pathogen to resist, to survive, to endure, and at the same time, it's lethal to the host. So, which is the main topic of our study today? An organism, you saw the way that it affects the human, and then it perpetrates, it endures, and eventually it eliminates the host if it is not treated. There is also resistance to human innate strepolinitic factor is resistant to killing by human serum component lymphatic factor guarantees the survival in spite of human innate immunity. The VSG coat, which we mentioned earlier on, is the dress that the trypanosome puts on. And it is that dress, that coat, that the human immune system recognizes in order to be able to eliminate the pathogen. However, it is able to continuously change that dress by expressing various genes and changing its coat, which makes some authors to refer to it as either dressing to kill or dressing for success, because it continuously changes its coat, confusing the host immune system and perpetrating itself, eventually eliminating the host if it is not treated. The disease is lethal if not treated, evolving into stage one, which is the hemolymphatic phase. At this point, the patient complains of intermittent fever due to host responses to parasitemia induced. The symptoms are usually unspecific and may be mistaken for malaria and bacterial infection. And this causes a delay in early diagnosis and early treatment. Lymph nodes and spleen become enlarged, showing the involvement of the reticuloendothelial system. The demonstration of cellular and humoral immunity depression by Greenwood et al. In 1973 explains the increased susceptibility of those with the disease to other secondary infection, which means the patient, all the victims that have been bitten by the fly and now carry this parasite, are dealing not only with the parasitic infection, their immune system is also depleted, which means they do not now have the capacity to fight off other infections. So the complications that result that could cause the lethality are numerous. The central nervous system, which is the last stage of the disease, is initiated when the parasite crosses the blood-brain barrier. We said before that the organism was motile and is able to propel itself, aided by the flagellum, to get to different disease sites, which is important in disease progression. The effect of the invasion results in increased cerebral vascular permeability and edema. Molyneux et al. 1996. Dumas and Bysar 1999. Stockdale et al. 2008. Also associated with the second stage of the disease is the production of autoantibodies that are directed against components of the CNS myelin and associated neurological stage of the disease. Eventually, the patient dies after prolonged coma. Because we know the seriousness of this disease, we now embark on a series of field activities which we conducted in Edo and Delta State for the betterment of society. Sleeping sickness is believed to be as a result of witchcraft. The reason the people believe that is that you have a disease, eventually, when it gets to the last stage of the disease, the individual, the victim, begins to manifest the CNS symptoms, which they call madness. Therefore, for somebody to have a disease and eventually become mad, it must be witchcraft. So they believe that the disease is witchcraft. We found that out during our study in 2001. However, those living in endemic areas of Edo and Delta states are at risk of infection and disease. They associate the disease with mental illness, and the victims are stigmatized and maltreated. Arahi et al. 2003. Sometimes, those infected with the disease are in danger or they are believed to pose a danger to others. So they tie them to trees. This is someone with the second stage of the disease. You can see this poor innocent man who just contracted the disease following the bite of the serpent fly is now being treated so badly, he's tied down, he cannot move because they believe he's mad and he's bewitched. During my field study, I dialogued with the people and I encouraged them to participate in efforts aimed at addressing the concerns of those affected by the disease and to participate in the following initiatives, which include neutralizing stigma, and encouraging changes in attributions made by inhabitants in endemic villages towards victims of the disease. However, there was some level of understanding of the epidemiology of the disease among the inhabitants, as it is known in the communities that Sassa fly blight transmits the disease. The local name for the fly is Oriogaga or Egbariba. In order to understand the factors affecting the pattern and spread of the disease, we conducted studies aimed at seeking out those infected for treatment. We conducted advocacy calls. We paid courtesy calls to traditional rulers, religious and youth leaders in order to explain the objectives of our survey and solicit the cooperation during our studies. Questions asked during our visits concerning the disease were answered by members of the survey team. The advocacy calls served to raise awareness about the disease, and we used the opportunity of our visits to internalize the importance of the control measures against the disease. Town criers were appointed to make public pronouncements as directed by traditional rulers to sensitize the people and to encourage them to turn up massively during our surveys. You can see us in a group photograph. That is the Opara Inland traditional ruler. And these are other chiefs in the area, religious leaders, members of my survey teams, and youth leaders. So we got full support and cooperation, because you don't just go into a community and begin to conduct studies. You have to get their support. They have to agree with you, because they can tell you that they don't want you to come and intervene in whatever it is that is they are posed with. So we got the full support. We started from the very highest leaders down to the youth leaders. This is a snapshot view at our control efforts. We identified a total of 159 cases for treatment. All our cases were treated at the Baptist Medical Center, because the WHO provides medication and support for the management of trypanosomiasis at the Baptist Medical Center. So between 1992 and May 2005, we had a total of 159 cases. However, we lost 4 cases due to drug reaction to the treatment. PTRE, which is post-treatment reactive encephalopathy, is due to the following: side effect of acute immune response to massive release of key parasites from drug therapy, deposition of immune complexes in the brain, autoimmune mechanism, arsenical toxicity, Kennedy 1999. Current therapy for CNS stage of the disease has unacceptable side effects, with overall mortality rate of about 5%, which is close to what we recorded during our study, Kennedy 2004. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I would like to at this point acknowledge some of my colleagues at the Baptist Medical Center. I would like to acknowledge and thank the management and staff of the Cook Baptist Medical Center for their support throughout my fieldwork. In particular, I must thank Dr. Kayode Adesina, who was the former medical director, for his interest in our survey and the care for those confirmed with the deadly disease. Dr. Adesina even offered me accommodation in his house when my hotel bills were getting very high. So Dr. Palmer Atakuru, I acknowledge him for his logistics and commitment to the project. Also, thanks to traditional rulers, religious and youth leaders for the support throughout the study. Our prevalent study between 1992 and 1997 reported a prevalence of 5%. The morbidity reported included splenomegaly 4.1%, cervical adenopathy 4.3%, and fever 3.8%. All cases were treated at the Baptist Medical Center. We concluded that more studies were needed to seek out cases for treatment in order to break the transmission. Airami, Ibadan, Omoigberale, Okaka, and Harlem. So we also conducted studies on knowledge, attitude, and beliefs between June and December 1998. And we found negative attitude towards inhabitants of the disease. And we concluded that for preventive and control measures to be effective, the associated stigma must be actively addressed. Irahi Okaka and Irahi. We also conducted a study to describe the first geographical distribution of the focus. And in that focus, we identified the following endemic villages: Eku, Oruoka, Abraka, Ugoro, Kwale, Obiaruku, Umuebu, Uronigwe, and Sanubi. This is the basis why we say that the disease is prevalent in some areas of Edo and Delta states. The Abraka sleeping sickness, which is now known as the ASSN, described by us in 2000, is a stretch of forested wetland along the margin of River Ethi. It's located between Edo and Delta states within the rainforest vegetation with an annual rainfall of about 2,218 mm and an average temperature of 27 degrees centigrade. We documented 9 villages and a total of 56,851 individuals at risk of infection. This is based on 1991 census figure. Some of the predisposing factors for the contracting of this disease include: most homes are built, people live near River Etio. You can see this residential area. See this young man, he's asleep, he can fall asleep, and that fly will come and do exactly what he did to the earlier man to him, and all the children born to that family. This is River Etio, and that is the vegetation that supports the breeding of the sesa fly that transmits the disease. The common occupation of the villagers living in the endemic area, which is what they declared to us during our study, included farming, fishing, bricklaying, and these activities exposed them to infected bites. The disease was found to be endemic among low-income population within the ASSF, which is the Africa Sleeping Sickness Focus, and this aggravates poverty and consequently low productivity. These are some outdoor activities that expose individuals living within areas endemic for the disease to infection. All these children go naked, and like as we said before, the fly is attracted to moving dark objects. And the fly also can bite fair-skinned people, but they bite through dark clothing, particularly stockings. We had several village activities in order to be able to actively detect cases. Actively detected cases provides double benefit, because any treatment of cases that are actively detected means that there's reduced risk of infection for humans, as well as improved livelihoods through increased productivity. Some of our field activities: blood collection and scar screening. That's me doing scar screening on the field. So any serial suspects, anybody who tests positive for scar screening, we further investigate in order to be able to confirm. When we are unable to confirm, we book them and follow them up in order to ensure that they are treated. And then the transmission can be broken when such follow-ups are carried out. The active case detection was between April 8th and May 2002. And this was Irahi and Irahi, an additional 2003. At this point, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I would like to acknowledge my current head of department, Dr. E. Yusuf, who provides me with support and an enabling environment to do my work. Dr. Yusuf, may your path continue to be bright. To my previous heads of department, Professor S.M.C. Wemambu of blessed memory, who was like a father to me, I'm grateful to him. I will always be grateful to him. He provided all I needed to develop my career. May his soul continue to rest in peace. Dr. Osayetin Yoha, I thank you for your kindness to me always. I say thank you and may God bless you. To Dr. Lafo, I say thank you. To the Chief Medical Laboratory Scientist, Mr. P. Otaigbe and Mr. O. Edogun, for their support and encouragement, as well as for their cooperation. To Dr. I. Osaigbo for her cooperation and the entire staff of the department. This is some of the symptoms that we recorded included winter bottom sign of cervical adenopathy, This child was one of the ones we saw during our field study. You can see an enlarged lymph node there. This was during our case study in the area. We also did passive case detection where we studied 78 individuals, and this was reported in the Sahel Medical Journals, Irahi, Idogun, and Omoemu and additional. These are other findings during the active case detection. If you take a look at this table, you find that there are some. In Old Walker, for instance, we had 85 CAP positive cases. We confirmed 61.5%. There was one in stage one and 7 in stage two. And down the line like that, in Ubono, we have seropositive cases, but we are not able to confirm during our field study. We followed them up, and subsequently during our follow-up, we were able to identify 14 cases for treatment. The biological criteria used for the confirmation of the second stage of the disease include CSF analysis, where more than 5 cells per microliter of CSF or the presence of trypanosin is diagnostic. The abnormal number of monocytic cells observed in the CSF correlate with the widespread meningeal inflammation seen during the disease. This is Dow and Botel 2006. The brain section during the second stage of sleeping sickness reveals inflammatory infiltrates called causing perivascular cuffs. More cells are the ones shown in the arrow, and this is the coffin made of inflammatory cells. We also have a smear of CSF showing morular cells. This morula cell is an abnormal plasma cell that contains vacuolation. The vacuolation in this cytoplasm is immunoglobulin, and it was described by Mott in 1905. And this report is by McLean et al. 2001. Morula cell of Mott is a large abnormal modified plasma cell seen with meningoencephalitic trypanosomiasis. But they are not definitive. That is, they are not pathognomonic. The cell was described by Dr. Mott in 1905. Although often described as Mott cell, Dr. William Russell actually described the plasma cell earlier in 1890. Beg your pardon for that title. Mott cells and Russell bodies occur in reactive plasmacytosis, Bain 2009. Control efforts that we conducted during our field survey, we had huge support from WHO. And at this point, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I would like to acknowledge with appreciation WHO and CDS for providing funds and melasoprol as well as analytical kits for surveillance projects and research activities. In particular, Dr. Janning of the WHO, Mr. F.A.S. Kuzo, and Pierre Catan, all of WHO, for their encouragement over the years. The confirmation of cases, like as I mentioned earlier on, was carried out following the follow-up. And we did identify up to 14 cases from the earlier several suspects that we were not able to confirm during our field study. Irahi, Idogun, Omoemu, and Irahi. The comparison of methods for the investigation of HAT became necessary because of the unspecific symptoms of the disease, and we were able to describe criteria for making that can lead to suspicion among cases, and this was reported in Annals of Biological Medical Sciences. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, permit me to acknowledge and express my appreciation to my family. I consider myself lucky and privileged to be associated with architect and Mrs. Ni Ibrimo, who have been a pillar of support for me and my family. May the Almighty bless you. Thank you, Alaja Risi Brimo, for your care, support, and help, which sustained me, especially in difficult times. Sir Lawrence and Lady Barrister, Mrs. Margaret Oyewole, thank you, Margaret, for standing by me always. Tony Obu, my cousin, I say thank you for your support always. Thank you, Professor Mrs. Hetty Obu, for standing by me and assisting with editing my manuscript. Hetty, may the Almighty send you help in your time of need. To my caring and supportive siblings, my older sibling and their spouses, Mr. and Mrs. Edwin Iyori, Mr. and Mrs. Emmanuel Iyori, Dr. and Dr. Mrs. Abraham Iyori, I thank you for your immeasurable love and support. To my younger siblings and their spouses, Mr. Charles and Mrs. Tope Iyori, Charles and Tope, thanks for your care during all my visits. God bless you. Professor Felix and Dr. Mrs. Charlotte Amekina, I say thank you for caring for me. Thank you, Charlotte, for showing me love in various ways, especially for finding placement with my sabbatical. Felix, thanks for the ride from campus during my sabbatical and help with getting my driver's license. Mr. and Mrs. Sidahome Iyori, Mr. and Mrs. Christian Iyori, Mr. and Mrs. Linia Utahagwa, Mr. and Mrs. Abonokwa, Mr. and Mrs. Ameze Clifford, and Mr. and Mrs. Ike Iyori, I appreciate you all. My deepest gratitude to my children for putting up with my long absence from home when you were very young during my field studies, lectures, travels, etc. Dr. and Mrs. Ahidi Ame Airahi, Mr. and Mrs. Oame Airahi, Dr. Osera Airahi. To my grandchildren, Usalume Nose Airahi, Michael Airahi, Usareme Airahi, Gabriela Airahi, Oseyime Nose Airahi, and Iwonwo Airahi. I thank the Iyori family of Uromi, Esangbedo and Obo families of Igwebe for standing by me. I thank all my in-laws, especially the Airahi family of Ihuane Iwo, my cousins, nephews, nieces, other relatives and friends for standing by me always. Also, many thanks to everyone that I have met so far in my journey through life by inspiring, challenging, encouraging, supporting and loving me, and so helping me to be the best that I have been. In this perspective, I reflect on the control efforts aimed at controlling this killer disease in Nigeria. Parasites are a major cause of global diseases, which include the African trypanosome. Trypanosomiasis, which is a wasting and fatal disease of medical and veterinary importance, has a wide spectrum of clinical presentation, coupled with differences in disease progression and severity in endemic areas of Africa. Our understanding of the African trypanosome suggests that the parasite is brutal, is genetically constituted to eliminate all its victims, and it is an enemy not easily vanquished. The impact of trypanosomiasis is high due to its treatment costs, high morbidity, and mortality. The availability of drugs for its treatment are highly toxic, and without treatment, the disease is always fatal. The continuing studies of the biology, including gene functions and gene expressions of the African trypanosome, represent a crucial route towards finding therapeutic solution for the vital disease. As more studies are conducted in our study areas, evidence suggests that the prevalence of the killer disease is on the decrease. Oswe et al. 2008. It is possible that our control efforts, which included active and passive plague detection, as well as treatment of confirmed cases, may have contributed to the decrease in cases. If this finding is to be sustained, controlled surveillance should be integrated into the health system needs of affected communities, where risks of infection remain high and where resurgence may occur at any time. The elimination of the disease was achieved in the Equatorial Guinea through active passive case detection and treatment of confirmed cases, Simaro et al. 2006. We hope that someday soon, sleeping sickness will become history in the ASSM. Various factors reported in our studies have been useful in the development of control and intervention programs in the ASSM. In order to prevent the rising prevalence of irreversible neurological disorders associated with the disease, there is need for diagnostic kits that should provide early and uncontroversial diagnosis for both stages of the disease. The kits should require minimum training to allow its use by all health workers in the area. There is the need for the establishment of vector control measures within the ASSN with the full cooperation of the affected communities and the need for the reduction of health impacts for people with sleeping sickness by providing affordable and accessible healthcare services. I thank God Almighty for all those who have contributed to the planning of this memorable day. For the gift of life and the journey of life so far, dear Lord, I say thank you. Thank you all for listening.
Michael Ibadi.
Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Michael Ebadin on Saturday celebrated his fatherless 40 years anniversary. And so for the past 40 years, he has been fatherless. We thank God for giving you strength. I also want to recognize the presence of the immediate past Deputy Vice Chancellor administration of this great university. And currently, he is the President of Nigeria Environmental Society and a fellow of the Nigeria Environmental Society, Professor Lawrence Ikechukwu Ezemoyan. I also want to recognize the presence of one man that has decided to help fight Lassa fever in Nigeria, the former Vice Chancellor of the Ambrose Ali University, Professor Amola. Honestly, the list before me is endless. We want to thank each and every one of us for coming around. The inaugural lecturer is inviting each and every one of us to a wonderful reception. For guests, Professor Abolamba has always asked me to emphasize, for guests only. If you are a professor, if you are a doctor, you form part of the guests. But if you are a student, you are a learner. You know now, based on logistics. And so for you not to fall victim of not having Nagana, you must go to where we ask you to go to for your own reception. And so the Vice Chancellor will lead the procession out of the auditorium, and immediately after that we shall let the students know where their reception will hold. May we please rise. Students, your reception will be at the car park.